Council Chambers. I'm City Councilor at Large Anissa Asabi George, Chair of the Committee on Homelessness, Mental Health, and Recovery. I'd like to remind everyone that this hearing is being recorded and broadcast live on Comcast 8 and RCN 82. I ask you to please turn off your cell phones and anything else that makes noise. This is a hearing for Docket 0133 to explore additional investments in mental health clinicians for the Boston Police Department. I ask everyone to please sign in, and if you'd like to speak after the panelists, please check the box for public comment. I'd like to first thank my co-sponsor, Councilor Ayanna Pressley, for her partnership in this effort. We'll be joined during the course of the hearing by my colleagues. I'd like to first recognize Councilor Josh Zakim, who is here. After learning about the BEST program during the last budget process, I was immediately impressed by the work they do providing mental health to mental health clinicians to ride along with Boston police officers and first responders. The BEST program provides officers with support when they encounter people in crisis situations. Individuals with mental health issues face broad stigma, which prevents them often from asking for and or accessing the services they need. This partnership is amazing because it rejects that stigma and also enhances the safety of those struggling with mental illnesses. And it protects the safety of our Boston police officers who respond to calls when mental illness is afflicting a resident. 67% of men and 75% of women in Suffolk County prisons are experiencing both substance use disorders and mental health disorders. In these cases, mental health professionals can help de-escalate situations and chart a path to treatment instead of incarceration. My hope is that by the end of this hearing, we'll clarify the challenges, financial costs, and understand possible savings of the BEST program and learn how to expand it so that every neighborhood in Boston can benefit from these services. I'd like to next recognize my co-sponsor and colleague and friend, Ayanna Pressley.
Thank you, Chairwoman. I thank the Chairwoman for her partnership and co-sponsoring this order with me for this important issue. Although our dedicated Boston police officers do receive specialized training, I believe licensed clinicians are best suited to assess and to de-escalate situations with emotionally disturbed persons. In the best interest of public safety and the public health for all parties involved, each police district should have a dedicated clinician for ride-alongs and to ensure an improved, more holistic and coordinated response. I also believe an increased financial investment will result in fewer arrests, working hand in glove with other criminal justice reforms that are currently underway, while connecting those battling mental illness and substance abuse disorders with the treatment and social services they so desperately need and deserve.
Thank you. And I'm not sure if Councilor Zakim, or we've been joined also by Councilor McCarthy, have any opening statements. Thank you very much. I'd also like to share just a brief notice from Councilor Campbell, who's unable to attend, and I'd like to read her letter into the record. Dear colleagues, regrettably, I am unable to attend today's hearing on the Committee on Homelessness, Mental Health, and Recovery, docket number 0133, regarding investments in mental health clinicians in the Boston Police Department. Thank you to the makers for this hearing order, Councilors Pressley and Asabi George, and I look forward to further conversation upon my return. So welcome all of you for joining us today, and I'd love to start with Commissioner Evans. We've got lots to share. Thank you.
Thanks, Councilors, for holding this meeting.
Thank you.
I have a great team here that you'll hear from, all in different areas of, the mental health profession, who all help us greatly and deal with this this issue. Right now we have two positions that we're in the process of filling, that we've had two individuals who did an outstanding job, who are out there with us in two of our police districts on ride-alongs with our officers. It's a great tool for us. As you know, a lot of our calls involve emotionally disturbed individuals, and to have a well-trained clinician on board to help us deal with those issues is paramount. I think it helps de-escalate situations. It helps us better track what services this individual needs. And you know, as you've seen over the last 2 years, you know, we've locked up or arrested 25% less, and we want to continue that goal. And locking up emotionally disturbed individuals isn't the solution. It's getting them the care. And to have these clinicians riding around with us, you know, and I know we spoke after the tragedy on Charmant Ave about the possibility of getting more on board to help our officers deal with situations is only a bonus for us. You know, Superintendent Holmes is here. She'll talk about the training. A lot of our new officers undergo a lot of crisis intervention training in their academy. We do in-service in training for officers who are out of the academy. We do a lot with it, but the more we can do to assist our officers in the field, so they have people who sometimes are better equipped to make the call on individuals who suffer from, you know, mental illness, the better off we are. So, you know, I just want to thank you for holding this hearing. Obviously, in our job, whether it's dealing with the opiate crisis or the mental health crisis, it's currently a big issue for us. We're also working with public health now to give our officers more crisis intervention training. We met, me and Superintendent Buckley, about 2 weeks ago with the idea of getting more and more training for the officers in this critical field. And so we realize a large majority of our calls involve individuals who don't need to be locked up. They need to get services they need. So,
thank you, Commissioner. Thank you. I'd like to go next to Chief Hooley. I'd like to just share some opening comments.
Good afternoon, Councilors Asabi George, Councilor Presley, members of the council, thank you. On behalf of Boston EMS, my name is Jim Hooley. I'm Chief of the Department, and I want to thank you for the opportunity to provide testimony today in support of this measure. Last year, Boston EMS's 358 uniformed department members responded to over 125,000 clinical incidents. 8,928 of those were assigned the type code EDP, which is a call type for emotionally disturbed persons. When a 911 call is placed in Boston that is a medical of nature, our EMT call takers ask pertinent questions to determine the most appropriate type code to assign to that incident: pedestrian struck, cardiac disorder, etc. A type code is used to both determine unit deployment, which agencies go, is it just EMS or police and or fire, and to inform the responding crews. An incident that is assigned the type code EDP, is assigned that type code if the patient exhibits behavioral abnormalities. Such calls are categorized as either EDP-3, which is a lower priority, in which the patient is showing unusual behavior with a psychiatric history, or perhaps the police department is on scene already and has requested a psych evaluation, or the patient is expressing suicidal ideation, but they're nonviolent, they're not injured, and a call may be entered as an EDP-2, which is a higher priority, if the patient is reported to be violent, is threatening others, has access to weapons, or perhaps is conscious after an attempted suicide. EDP-2 calls require a joint response by the Boston Police Department and Boston EMS. Our standard procedure is to dispatch a unit, but to hold short of the scene or entering the building until the BPD report that the scene is secure. Since 2012, we've experienced a 2% annual increase in calls from emotionally disturbed persons, with a total of 39,596 EDP incidents over the last 5 years. In 2016 alone, Boston EMS responded to 5,939 EDP-2 calls, the higher priority ones, which necessitate a simultaneous response with the police. That's an average of 16 times a day, and 4,061 times that resulted in a patient being transported. Of the EDP-2 calls in 2016, 973 of those number required the application of some sort of restraint to ensure the safety of the patient and or others. And 20% of the injuries and unprotected exposures to Boston EMS personnel have occurred on EDP calls. All certified EMTs receive basic familiarization and training in behavioral emergencies, and EMTs hired by Boston EMS are provided additional instruction. And during the six-month recruit academy, they learn how to properly evaluate and treat people who are exhibiting behavioral emergencies while suffering from mental illness. EMTs and paramedics responding to an EDP call are presented with a variety of challenges. As clinicians, they have been called upon to care for the medical needs of the patient. For example, does the person have a medical condition that's causing the behavior, such as hypoglycemia, a reaction to a newly prescribed medication, a seizure disorder, or a prior head injury? Is the patient under the influence or withdrawing from a substance? Is there a history of mental illness? And is the patient compliant with their medications? There are many cases where a patient may have a combination of these factors. EMS also has to rapidly assess the situation, maintain scene safety, and potentially de-escalate a situation where there's a lot of stress on the patient, the families, and the bystanders. The patients include individuals of all ages, pediatric to geriatric, ranging from those who have no previous behavioral issues to those who have had a lifelong history of behavioral abnormalities or mental illness. They can be found at home, in a school, in a shelter, at a group home, or on a street, in every neighborhood of our city. I've given you a lot of numbers, but it's not lost on the members of Boston EMS that these are individuals that are behind every one of these numbers. In many instances, there are families, loved ones, and friends who have been dealing with these patients and their problems for many years, and they're now resorting to dialing 911 during a crisis. Boston EMS is in support of the Boston Police Department's efforts to partner with the Boston Emergency Services Team. Having the availability of trained and experienced mental health professionals brings additional expertise and solutions to certain situations and settings, enhancing treatment and follow-up options, and possibly reducing future encounters for these patients. They could also serve to help navigate a patient in need of definitive psychiatric care. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Thank you, Chief. I'd also like to recognize that we've been joined by Councilor Matt O'Malley. Thank you. So I'm not sure anyone else on the panel has opening remarks that they'd like to share before we move on to the presentation. All right, so we'll go on to the presentation, and please feel free to comment as needed. Introduce yourself for the record, and then...
Sure, we're going to tag team.
That's fine. Okay. Both of you introduce yourselves,
okay,
please, for the record.
And it's okay to do it from here.
Yep, absolutely.
All right, well, I'm... Good afternoon. I'm Jenna Savage, Senior Research Coordinator for the Boston Police Department.
And I'm Tasha Ferguson, the Clinical Director for the Boston Emergency Services Team.
You kick it off.
Great. Oh. Who has the clicker for the slide?
Sam Shelter, Boston Police Department, and I have the clicker. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, to provide some brief background information on the BEST program as a whole, we are a mobile psychiatric crisis team that's staffed by master's level clinicians, and those masters are in fields such as social work, psychology, or mental health counseling. The BEST services available in all of Suffolk County, including, of course, the city of Boston, every day, 24 hours a day. And our goal is to respond to people in the community who are exhibiting signs of mental illness. And the goal there is to reduce emergency department overcrowding and waits. As we know, many people seek their care in emergency departments regardless of underlying issue. That includes mental health issues. However, emergency departments are not always the most appropriate place for them to be served. And so by responding to the community, we hope to reduce use of the emergency department by people with mental illness. The clinicians who staff our team are experts in emergency psychiatric evaluation, and they are also experts in linkage to other ongoing treatment services. In addition to the clinicians who respond in the field, there's also access to 24/7 consultation and additional referral information available at our call center, which is able to be reached at the number above. 800-981-4357, and those staff also are master's prepared clinicians, so able to assist with psychiatric triaging at the time of that call. In addition to those resources that I mentioned, there's also access to on-call psychiatrists who are employed through Boston Medical Center, as well as team supervisors. And those layers of supervision are important to ensure a high quality of care to all of the members of the community that we serve through BEST. Additionally, we have Community Crisis Stabilization Unit that we oversee, which is a voluntary unit that people from the community are able to elect to receive their care at, similar in nature to an inpatient unit, but again, on a voluntary basis from the people who choose to receive their care there. Additionally, we partner closely with Boston Medical Center and Mass General Hospital emergency departments to serve clients who receive their care in those settings. And part of that is the availability of our electronic medical record to staff who are present in those emergency departments. This electronic medical record is shared also by the call center and mobile clinicians that I referenced earlier. And by using this web-based electronic medical record, we're able to share information across all of our services for clients who are served at any of these locations, as well as locations within the community. On this slide, we have some volume numbers, which I'll just summarize. Our total volume for calendar year 2016 was over 19,000 individual encounters. About 14,500 of those were adults, and an additional 4,800 were youth. You can see from the location of service that over a third of the individuals that we served this past year were served in the community, and then the remainder were served at either the emergency departments that we partner with or at the other seven Boston area hospitals, which our mobile staff go into to provide service. Some examples of locations of those community visits, just over 2,200 visits were directly to homes, as well as 855 visits that were conducted on site at a school, a Boston Public School. I will remark on that number that we receive an additional number of referrals from schools. However, we see the youth at their homes or at another site that's chosen by the family. So schools may still refer a youth, even if we don't see them on site at the school location.
Can I just ask very quickly, I'm sorry.
Of course.
How many, do you know how many referrals you get from school-based sources?
It's not easy to capture, and I will say that the reason for that is schools can call us directly, but they can also suggest to parents or guardians that they contact us for evaluation if their youth is in need of service, and so it's not a number that's very clearly defined. However, I would say that of those, 4,800 youth that were served last year, all of them go to school, and in all cases where we're seeing a youth, we do try to involve the school directly in our evaluation process.
Thank you. Sorry about that.
No problem.
I'm going to go over some numbers a little bit, but it seems like Chief Hooley did a great job of already overviewing that. But just to recap, in 2016 alone, EMS responded to about 3,000 EDP-3 calls. Those are the lower level calls that require just an EMS response. And there were about 6,000 EDP-2 calls that require a co-response from both EMS and from BPD. And just keep in mind that that is probably highly underreported. Those are based on just the nature codes of EDP-3 and EDP-2. But chances are there's a mental health component in several other types of calls, including general disturbance, family trouble, domestic, investigate person. So it really is hard to capture just how much we're seeing. So the numbers are already high, but just imagine they're probably a lot higher than the records are going to show. Oh, this is back to you.
The Boston Emergency Services team has been called to the community to assist with an individual. There are a number of different ways that that assistance can take place. So there are those who present with relatively high acuity, meaning that they're highly impacted at that moment by their mental health symptoms. In those cases, for safety purposes, we are able to work with our psychiatrist to issue a Section 12 and transport that person to an emergency department if that is the correct location of care for them. We also are able to work directly with an officer at the scene that the officer has been called to in order to provide stabilization and evaluation in that moment. And then additionally, we're able to follow up after an officer or another member of the community has been involved with an individual with mental health concerns and provide them service after that initial interaction, you know, particularly in this case with the police, but with other treaters as well. We also, in our work with the police, have conducted psychiatric crisis evaluations in holding cells. And in the process there, we're providing both a safety assessment, but also some de-escalation to the individual who we're evaluating. Again, that person can be moved safely to an emergency department if that's required. And we also are the pathway through which the designated forensic professional is contacted in the case that process needs to be followed through. Some of the situations in which we have continued to work on folks who are also involved with the police are through individuals who repeatedly call 911 requesting service due to paranoia or some other symptoms of mental illness. We have worked with families and also victims who have been exposed to or directly involved in traumatic events. We provide some stabilization through the use of our master's prepared clinician for interpersonal and family issues that may have arisen. We help to assess or provide an initial assessment for geriatric mental health issues. Certainly, we are called frequently for juveniles who are exhibiting behavioral problems at home, at school, or in the community. And, you know, one of our goals, again, is to prevent individuals from reaching the emergency department who don't require service at that location. And so in our work with the police and with EMS, diverting those individuals from ambulance rides or emergency department visits, we see here that an estimated cost savings of about $4,000 per diversion. That's been successful.
While we're here today is that so far our partnership has been entirely grant funded. And a shout out goes to Andrea Hall from Best, who first came to the BPD in 2010. She's the reason why we're here. She pitched us applying, and I truly can't remember which came first, but there was an FY10 DMH grant, and there was an FY10 BJA, Justice and Mental Health grant, both of which we were awarded. And we've consistently had DMH funding since then. BJA we've had off and on. But between all the state and federal funding, through previous grants, we've been able to beef up Best 24-hour emergency phone lines so we could have 24/7 access for our officers. We developed an e-learning curriculum for our academy, which has now been viewed by every officer, that introduces them to who Best is and how Best and when Best to contact them. And they were largely not known amongst officers before that e-learning went out. And word has definitely gotten out since then. So as officer word gets out, more and more officers are much more familiar with the idea of a Best clinician and the usefulness of them. We've also had, over time, two full-time Best clinicians, both of which still exist. One is the DMH-funded position, which has existed since 2010. That one covers districts B2, B3, and D4 currently. And is unfortunately, it is vacant because the clinician went into our academy. But you'll hear from Officer Sullivan and Sergeant Silta about how great it's been riding along with him. We also had a full-time clinician through BJA funding in Area C. And this is where you get to the heart of it, you know, being a problem relying on grant funding, is that that grant expired at the end of, I believe, May 2016, and so we lost that position at the time. And we have now been given a new grant, but we lost that person, and he had worked really hard to establish relationships. He was doing, you know, he earned officer trust, but now he is gone. So with this new grant, we now have to replace him, and it's just hard to start all over again. The instability of these grant funds is really a problem when it comes to this type of relationship where you really have to earn officer trust. It's not easy taking a civilian, I'm sure, riding along. I should also mention that through our DMH funds, we also have a part-time peer specialist, which is enormously helpful, that Best provides us with peer services. We can't say enough about that as well. Through our current BJA grant, not only are we hoping to fill our Area C Best Clinician position, but we're also very excited to be partnering with Dr. Melissa Morabito out of UMass Lowell, who's very sorry she could not be here today. She's teaching. But we're going to do a formal evaluation focused largely not only on just the number of diversions, but also cost savings, because we know it's huge. DMH estimates it's about $4,000 every time there's an emergency, an ambulance ride, and an ED visit. So based on that number, and we'll get to that in a second, but we know we have saved the city hundreds of thousands of dollars every time we're able to divert from arrest or from an emergency department. But it's been really hard to prove. So we're going to work with Melissa, we're really Dr. Morbido, to really do it a formal evaluation to show what we're saving the city with this program. We're also going to do an EDP pilot program because currently the clinicians have to ride along with officers who still have to respond to other non-EDP calls, which can be not the best use of clinicians' time, but it's just how it is. Captains have minimum staffing levels that they have to stick to. So we're going to do, I think, it's a two-month pilot program, which we've done once before, where we can actually have a dedicated EDP car that is dedicated solely to EDP response, but can also do proactive follow-up. Officers are encouraged to leave incident reports for clinicians so that in their downtime they can go follow up and, again, reduce the likelihood of these high utilizers actually calling again and hopefully intervening before they need emergency services. So we're going to do a pilot program there and try to estimate how much that costs and versus how much it saves, because we'll have the funding to cover the overtime for the backfill for the officer. And I think that's it for me.
So again, just some information about our partnership thus far with the police. Per data that we've been able to retrieve from our electronic medical record, when we were looking at 2010, there were 25 individuals who were referred directly from Boston Police to BEST. By comparison, if we're looking at 2015, BPT referred 440 individuals, which is a 1,660% increase during that time frame. Additionally, from the launch of the program in 2011 through the end of the past calendar year, there were 516 people who could have been arrested, and this is per officer report, that were diverted to mental health resources. Looking at the period from January 1st to June 30th of the previous year, and this is just some statistics that were gathered by our co-responders and from the electronic medical record, 93 interventions occurred where the ambulance or emergency department services were avoided when they could have been utilized in another circumstance. Per estimates from the Department of Mental Health, these 93 interventions resulted in $372,000 in savings. Additionally, 33 people were seen holding cells while in police custody. That therefore avoided trips to the emergency department for those 33 individuals, which would have required two officers' time to transport and maintain custody of those folks while they were in the emergency department. Additionally, Boston Police referred or sought consultation on another 59 people, additional to those 33, as well as another 142 that were referred by contacting the BEST Jail Diversion clinicians directly. And I think that really speaks to the relationship that our co-responder clinicians were able to develop with the officers, where officers felt comfortable going directly to them as an individual rather than even utilizing our call center. So the total there is 183 assessments and 18 consultations that we were able to achieve just during that 6-month time frame.
And
thank you very much. I'd also like to recognize that we've been joined by Councilor Flaherty and Council President Wu. Thank you both for joining us. Anyone else on the panel want to share any comments before we get to question and answer?
Councilor, good afternoon. Sam Silta, I'm the Sergeant of Community Service in Roxbury. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen from the City Council. I've been a police officer for 22 years. I teach at the master's level up at Curry College. I teach for the Massachusetts Training Council. One of the disciplines is police response to mental illness. I teach for the Department of Bureau of Justice Assistance, so I travel all around the country lecturing on what are some of the different things that the Boston Police does that everybody else is interested in. I get phone calls and emails on a regular basis from colleagues from around the country asking what it is that Boston is doing differently. And I think that we can all pride ourselves on the fact that we do things a lot differently in the city of Boston. One of the things I talk about is the BEST team, okay? And it's not just the folks that we call through the 800 number. It's the fact that we have a BEST team clinician that would ride with the officers at nighttime in the city, responding to calls all around the city. So they respond along with us. And to go back as a practitioner, as a police officer, going back my 22 years, at first when we knew very little and had very little training on mental illness and our response to it. And when we had a high utilizer of the 911 system, the way we used to make the problem go away was to make the person go away. So we would arrest that person. Okay, we would arrest them. Sometimes it would be a conflict, and we'd wind up having to bring the person into the station. Sometimes that person would have to be transported to the hospital. If not, they would go to the court. They would sit up in the court. They would see Judge Coffey over West Roxbury Court. And then later on in the afternoon, around 3 or 4 o'clock, I'd see them again at Dunkin' Donuts. So the problem would go away for about 8 hours. And then about 10 years ago, we started to realize that there's something more to this. And we said, oh, well, this is mental illness, or this is alcoholism, or this is drug abuse. And we would call Boston EMS, and then the good folks from Boston EMS would show up and take the person off to the ED. The problem with that was is that they would overload the EDs and overload the ambulances, and sometimes backlog the ambulances that needed to go to a higher priority call. I know that for a fact there was one call in Roxbury that when we had the best team clinician dealing with it, he freed up an ambulance that went to a stabbing call, which wound up resulting in the saving of a life. And then once the best team came along, we realized that we can deal with high utilizers of the 911 system in a much different way. So we would visit the person, sometimes in off hours, not when we were getting called by them through 911, but I'd get a request to the operations division to respond along with the best team clinician. And one of the best things that the best team clinician can do is make contact with their service providers, whether that be their doctor or psychiatrist or psychologist. And maybe what they need to do is bring that person in to step up services, maybe have a change of medication, okay? And that we found that we would have a vast reduction in calls to the 911 system. Also, as a police supervisor, when I'm acting in an acting lieutenant's role on the desk, we would have prisoners in the cell block that are suffering from mental illness, which would require a cell block extraction. Okay, that's where we go in and physically remove the person who may want to harm themselves in the cell block, which again would require Boston EMS services. What happens with the best team clinician, they can come in and speak with the person, make contact with their service providers, and then offer that person outpatient services. Okay, maybe what we have to do is summons that person in instead of keeping them in custody for more than 24 hours. And then along with responding to the officers in the field, to people with mental health disorders. And Officer Sullivan will be able to speak at great length to that. But speaking to this program, having the best team clinician able to respond with the officer it unburdens Boston EMS. It unburdens the court system, right? And we realize now that most of these folks don't belong in a jail cell. Most of these folks don't belong in the emergency department. They need services right away, which we can offer them right away. We can drive them right over to 85 East Newton Street and offer them outpatient services immediately. And that's one of the things that I think that we do here in the city that's much different than anywhere else in the country. There's a lot of social services out there that may or may not work, you know, 40 or 50% of the time. I think the city of Boston residents, right, and when I ask, I don't ask for myself. I always ask for my residents. The city of Boston residents don't deserve 40 or 50% of the time. They deserve 100% of the time. And I'm of the opinion that my agency, along with Boston EMS and the best team, are going to try to do their best to provide 100% of the time, all the time. Thank you.
Thank you, Sam. Thank you. So what I'd love to do now is open it up to some questions by my colleagues. We can get through at least a round, and then we'll have more to add. Councilor Presley?
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman, and thank you, Commissioner, for being here and for your enthusiastic endorsement of the best model and the need to increase the capacity of it. So could you just speak from a cost perspective and from your vantage point, sort of ideal model scenario, would we have a clinician for each district? What would their hours be?
Right.
And what are we talking about in terms of cost?
Well, you know, maybe Jenna can talk to the cost individually, but you know, ideally, if we had one in each district, and, you know, that would be on call if we needed them. But more or less, 4 to 12, for the most part, is when we find most calls. And I think our goal is to have
4
him.
4 p.m. to 12 a.m.?
Yeah. And also to train up more officers. Currently, we're working with Solomon Fulham Carter to get training, the crisis intervention training, with all our officers. So, like, if they can get trained up, especially the community service officers, they'd always be available during the daytime. And so the perfect model would be to train more officers up in CIT training, but also to have...
Which we'll hear more about shortly. So currently they receive a specialized 12-hour training. Yeah, we'll be hearing from Sergeant.
Superintendent Lisa Holmes can talk about the training they get.
Right.
She's here, but it's, you know, we can't rely solely on the best clinician, you know, because there's just not enough of them. But, you know, to also have the officers pick up the slack when they're not around, but to have an in-house expert like that has really saved us a lot as far as, you know, hospital visits, transports, and tying our officers down the hospital. But
no, I appreciate that very much, and I'm encouraged to hear that there is an effort underway to evaluate and quantify those cost savings, you know, even more specifically. You know, had thought about the savings from a criminal justice standpoint, but had not considered the implications in terms of emergency room visits and the like. So I do have a couple of questions about that, too. I did have a question, Commissioner. You were talking about the reduction in arrests.
Right.
And I was just curious if there's one specific, I thought originally that that statistic was specific to youth arrests. Because a number of young people maybe had. Okay, so
it's
overall, just a general?
In general.
Okay.
You know, I think last year it might have been 16%. This year it was 9%. So, you know, and already this year I think we're down 17% from where we were last year at this time. So between two things, obviously dealing with the mentally ill and doing referrals, but also with the opiate crisis, you know, having the ability to deal with, you know, our bicycle units down there, we're dealing as opposed to locking up the users down there, we're also doing referrals with them. So I think that has had a significant reduction in our numbers also. And I think of, you know, our crime continues to come down, but I think Mayor Walsh, myself, and the department are more proud of the fact that, you know, we're diverting kids and adults and mentally ill and the opiate addicted out of the system to get the services they need.
Thank you, Commissioner. And to that end, I was just curious if there are providers that you most frequently refer to. Was just curious if there are people you work more closely with in terms of sort of that continuum of care and a warm handoff.
Truthfully, it depends on the population versus health. So we're looking to identify specifically based on which depending on sort of what the specific needs of the individual are. So if there's a specific group, I can certainly try to speak to that, but otherwise, I think it really does depend on, you know, the individual person.
Counselor,
yes.
If we can, we have Judge Coffey here from West Roxburghwood. I think she has some knowledge of how they do some of the referrals, right?
Okay. Hi, how are you?
Some remarks, but if you want me to answer
well,
a question.
Well, I'll defer to the chair of the committee.
I'm
continue
flexible.
Here because I think we'd like to hear an opening statement.
Yeah, I'd love to hear an opening statement from you. So why don't we just do a quick round?
Okay.
I'm just anxious that we may lose the commissioner.
Okay. Yeah.
Speaking.
Well, I didn't want to lose her either, so that's why I try to get her on.
Thank you.
She took her time out to come, so I just wanted.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for being
Thank
here.
Thank you. Councilor Pressler, do you have additional questions?
Yes, I just had a question. Just given the obvious health disparities that persist, could you speak to in terms, so one, would you credit the increase in the intentional partnership between BPD and the BEST team to the e-curriculum? That jump that more officers became aware, so from that 25 to the 400 plus, is that what you would credit that to? Okay. And then secondly, given that health disparities do persist, do you find that for the lion's share of your EDP calls and where the team is being deployed, that you're in some neighborhoods more than others? Could you speak to any trends or patterns there?
I think that, you know, we certainly are serving all of the communities of Boston every day. When I look at the two offices that cover sort of two halves of Boston, the busier office is the one that covers the Dorchester, Roxbury, Mattapan, South End, and South Boston area. Geographically, that team sort of covers that entire swath of Boston, and of our two teams, that is the busier team overall. So I think that's sort of as specifically as I can probably answer that.
Okay, and then just two more quick questions. We didn't get an answer on the cost. Could you speak to that? So we heard from the commissioner, but from your vantage point, again, what would be the best model? I see you're, you know, playing around with some different things, intrigued by the idea of a dedicated, car, if you will. But from an ideal scenario, just so we know, as fiscal stewards and in our advocacy, you know, what should we be advocating for? What would be most helpful?
I mean, as far as the cost of the clinicians go, I've been told it's about $100,000 per year for a full-time clinician. That's about what we estimate, given the shift differentials and everything that goes on. And again, the clinicians work directly for BMC. They're not BPD employees.
And the grant funding, has that always been annual, or is any of it multi-year?
Multi-year. Well, the DMH is year-to-year, but they've given it to us in three-year chunks, if that makes any sense. We've been pretty much guaranteed 3 years at a time. Currently, we've got FY16 through FY18. We're right in the middle of that. I think we just started FY17. JMH grant, I believe, is a two-year grant.
Okay. And then final question for this round, and thank you, Madam Chair. Again, given the health disparity issue, and someone was mentioning about following up with someone's specific provider or physician, we know there are many people battling mental illness that are not under anyone's care. So I was just curious, what do you do when someone does not have a primary care physician and is not under the care of anyone?
We certainly encounter a number of people, as you suggest, that are not directly connected to care at the time we encounter them, and that will be one of our interventions for that individual, is to find a resource, both physical health as well as mental health, to sort of address all of their needs. So depending on the area in which they're going to be able to access care most easily, we're going to look at all the providers in that area and try to help them to establish both a primary care clinician as well as a mental health clinician, because, you know, we certainly know that both of those elements are very important for someone's ongoing health.
All right, wonderful. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman.
Thank you. Councilor O'Malley.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I will be brief. Thanks to both of you, Councilors Sabi George and Presley, for your leadership on this issue. It is always great to be with my colleagues, and typically when I'm with Judge Coffey and Commissioner Evans, we're at a road race, so I see the back of their heads for about 5 seconds before they take off, and I'm at the back of the pack. But I mean, needless to say that you all have articulated the incredible importance of looking at mental health, not only as a public safety, but a public health issue as well. The brief success stories that we have seen, or the metrics that have come, show how important it is. And I will certainly be advocating during the budget process to increase the number of clinicians so that we can allow you to have more resources to do your job. Not only is it good for public safety, it's good for public health. And my only question, because I do want to hear from Judge Coffey and others, is how is the relationship with some of our community health centers? We all know mental health is something, we all know we have family members who are suffering from mental health issues. Oftentimes it's just making sure that they continue on a level of care, sometimes with psychotropic drugs, sometimes without, but just having that sort of steady level of care. We've got some great community health centers. How do we work with Martha Elliott, for example, in Jamaica Plain, or Southern Jamaica Plain Community Health Center, to name two? Anyone wants to just sort of make sure we get that aftercare for these folks?
Sure, and I can speak to that from our perspective. I think it's a two-way relationship, in the sense that we both refer individuals to receive care at those locations, because care within your own neighborhood is often the most accessible type of care for folks. So that's certainly something that we utilize from that end. And then on the other side, we continue to work and build our relationships with those community health centers to rely on the best team as a resource for their clients who do experience some mental health crisis. So we have occasions where the community health centers will invite us on site to the health center to conduct an evaluation, as well as referring their people who receive their care there for us to visit them at home if that's going to be a more suitable location. So I would say that the relationship is one that we build both by providing service there, sending referrals to those health centers for people who need to receive their care, you know, and additionally, we have made ourselves available to present to staff meetings and, you know, for ongoing communication outside of a crisis with those health centers, because I think the relationship and the trust is a really key
part of that whole system.
And do you have the bandwidth to just, perhaps not, and hopefully we can help that in this budget season, but just to make sure that someone that you refer who may not have had access to seeing a psychiatrist or some regimen, to make sure that they continue to go and see a clinician or a social worker or a psychiatrist?
One of the things that we provide is follow-up phone contact for individuals that we've seen in the community. So in that way, we're able to try to ensure that they've made that connection and that it's a lasting connection. I would say that one of our areas where we don't have as much information is that people are sort of electing to call us. And so at a certain point, we're relying on feedback from the community to know what's going on for any given individual's care. So we have some capacity, but there's certainly some missing information there as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Council President Wu.
And thank you so much to Councillor Presley and yourself for leading the charge on this. So important. I really apologize for being late earlier. So I'm mostly here to listen. I did just want to also add my voice to the swell saying we're in full support of increasing the resources and for all the reasons that you mentioned that spill over beyond public safety. It seems that we are short now in terms of having sufficient capacity to address the need, but also the stability you mentioned or the lack of stability when it's year to year makes it difficult for planning purposes. I want to just emphasize one point also on stability as it relates to being able to expand beyond just a pure public safety focus and the need, if we're going to think about providing resources for residents in terms of prevention and before it gets to crisis, heartbreaking to watch families, and we know from personal experience that many families feel like they can only get help at the point where something bad has either happened or is about to happen, and they just are sort of waiting for that, where leading up to it you can sort of see signs and want to reach out for help but not knowing where to turn for that help. So having a team in place that might be based at BPD but also in close contact with the schools, as you mentioned, with BHA, with community health centers and other places where either family members might be able to provide feedback or somehow flag that there might be need for help before it gets to the point of a major crisis. Is that type of sort of multi-prong or multi-agency approach possible at a certain level of resources, or are there other models where these are BPD based clinicians, but they work very closely or maybe spend their time rotating throughout other agencies in different cities as well?
I think one of the benefits to the BEST system as a whole is that we do have those outreach efforts into the other areas that you're suggesting, schools, community health centers, other areas where people seek care. And so particularly by the use of our electronic medical record, which all of our clinicians have access to, we can reach people who have never had an previous interaction with the police, but that we have seen at school or at their community health center. We have that ongoing information about them and relationships with their treaters or other involved parties, so that if we do encounter them through Boston Police Department, we have some background information about how to serve them most uniquely as an individual. So I think just the clinicians who correspond with the police, because it's such a small part, I think it's difficult to have the kind of reach into the community that you're describing. But as part of the BEST system as a whole, I think that that's something that we can definitely achieve.
Thank you. Appreciate that. I just have a couple of quick questions because my colleagues did such a great job asking theirs. When does that EDP code get assigned? Is that at point of the 911 call?
Yeah, it is. I think it will come in. Jimmy, you can talk probably better, but at the 911 call usually is, and they'll dual dispatch it sometimes, right, Jimmy?
Yeah, correct. Yeah, it's taken to the call center.
And then you mentioned twos and threes. Is there a one?
No. I'm not sure what it appears. That's a dispatch priority. So it's like the ones, the unconscious, the choking, the kind of like some of the other ones there, that the immediate dispatch, that lots of times police, fire, EMS, shooting, stabbing. The trees
are, they're a, that's just a tier for the dispatcher when he or she is
looking
at the screen.
But there's no EDP one?
No, no.
Okay. No. And then I know there's a challenge in identifying what the true EDP number is, because maybe family members don't want to identify or share that information. Is there ever an opportunity, so that we have a truer picture of what's happening, is there an opportunity to change the coding after a call has been done so that we have more accurate data?
I mean, we can always do that, because as we've shown, you know, domestic calls or, you know, other calls, I a lot of times in the morning, a child not wanting to go to school, there's a lot of issues, but that's clearly something that we can look into tracking it better, as to if there's any type of emotional disturbed person there. But right now, all we have is how the call came in, and a lot of them we don't discover till we're there, which makes sometimes a very volatile situation, that there's more to the domestic call than we thought. But clearly, if we need to track something like that, if the officer can go into his computer when he is missing the call to make that notation, that's something we can look to do.
Thank you. I wonder if that'd be helpful, just to have more. We base every decision now on data. So if we have more accurate data, we can make better assumptions.
You raise a good point, Counselor. The EDP is, you know, our best criteria that's applied if somebody's, you know, perhaps, you know, acting bizarre, somebody's acting out at Government Center T, yelling, screaming, you know, and for example, I'm just saying that. Now, that could be somebody who's has some sort of mental illness, or it could be somebody who was smoking K2, and when that wears off, they're going to be fine. So the fact is, we're approaching it that way because we have to go and make that determination. And lots of times, you know, so it is appropriate that some of those folks do wind up in the emergency room, and so they can determine if there's a medical reason for that. But on the other hand, there are patients who are known to us, known to the police, known to the best team, that and you might have a family member, somebody on scene, who could explain that, so this gentleman's got a history of this, he's been having some issues taking his medication, he's followed up. It's a lot different. You can, like, drill down a little bit more and, again, perhaps certainly divert them from the criminal justice system, but maybe even divert them from the emergency room, trying to get them somewhere where their clinician is who can care for them for that. So it's, I would say it's almost similar sometimes to when we're tracking narcotic-related illnesses. But there are very few calls where somebody calls up and say, hey, can you send an ambulance? I think somebody just overdosed on heroin. They may come in as an unknown. They may come in as an unconscious, or as a cardiac arrest, or a person not breathing, right? And then when it's upon review of the charts that we're able to see certain keywords or syndromes there to put it in. So we could take a look to see if we could further refine what our EDPs do in fact turn out to be.
Thank you. And then my last question is about the grant function and sort of the issue that being grant funded provides. Can you just, I know that we have one more year with the DMH grant, and then what's the second, the BJA one, how much more time do we have with that grant?
The BJA grant is an FY16 grant that just had a start date of October 1st of this past year. We haven't even gotten started yet, and it's a two-year grant. I'm assuming we'll need to get an extension because we have not hired that position.
And so it doesn't technically start until you hire? So you
right, essentially, because that's where the bulk of the funding goes, and we can't really evaluate until we do that. And so I think we'll end up needing to do an extension past the two-year point. But technically, it should expire September 30th, 2018. But I'm guessing we'll probably go another maybe year after that to spend it all down. And then DMH, currently we're in FY17, which will go through, I think they're July to June. So I think that will expire June 30th of this year. And we'll have another year through June 30th of next year, with the assumption that we'll probably get more. We tend to get re-upped there. The state, we should acknowledge, the state tends to prefer crisis intervention team training. Which is not our formal adopted model. A crisis intervention team is when you have an actual team of officers who go through 40 hours of training, and then they are the responders. There is no mental health partner.
But the training itself, as the commissioner was saying, is invaluable, and we're trying to get as many of our officers trained in that as possible. The challenge there is that for some officers, the only cost really is backfill for 40 hours of training. CSOs, you don't have to worry about that, so it's great. So we're going to try and do that training for as many as possible. But DMH also does prefer CIT, so hopefully they will continue to fund us despite us not doing that formal model. But I hope we'll continue to get funded past FY18.
I mean, the grants are nice, but I think we're all in agreement.
Yep.
That instability that you spoke of just really creates too much nervousness in the system.
And it does.
It'd be nice to have a lot more predictability. But, great. Yeah, Councilor Presley.
First, again, I just want to say thank you all for your participation and just what you do every day in the name of public safety and health in the city. Commissioner, you were speaking about, you know, one of the things that we could do hand in glove in addition to wanting to scale this program up, but was to invest in a greater sort of cross-training, which the superintendent will speak to, for officers. I recall in a briefing, maybe someone had mentioned that in EDP situations that often a person can be more provoked when someone in a uniform is approaching them. So I just, in wanting to keep everyone safe, could you just speak to that? Because although I would love to see a greater investment in that training, just in terms of the safety of everyone, that was some feedback that we had received, that people are sort of more worked up when someone's approaching in a uniform. So,
yeah, that does happen. And sometimes when we receive the call, that is made in the notation that please no lights and siren and whatnot. I know we dealt with Berklee School of Music on several issues like that, that if they have an EDP call, they would prefer us coming that way. Obviously, because of the students and not wanting, but also that can provoke. So, you know, usually in the narrative, they'll say, can you sometimes make a quieter approach? And, you know, we usually work with the ambulance. If it's a violent EDP, they won't sometimes go there until we get into the situation and try to calm it down. So there's always that issue. And usually we rely on the caller to sort of let us know if there's more to the call, and they might bring up to us, you know, will you please silently come up to the
scene? And then in terms of the caller, because I know Councilor O'Malley had done some good work in this space around people with loved ones that are living with Alzheimer's, is there anything proactive for the families that are watching this hearing, you know, online from home, that have a loved one that is dealing with mental health challenges? Is there anything proactive they can do, a coding or a phone call that they can say, you know, I'm not always here with my loved ones. Sometimes they go off their meds. If you're ever dispatched here, you need to know that this person is battling bipolar. Is there a code or anything proactive like that that family members can do?
Well, I think, you know, obviously we have that quite frequently. Every night we seem to be looking for someone who's missing with complications. And when that happens, you know, we call out our emergency deployment team. And then usually the dispatcher will red flag that address in the future. So if we get that call, we know that the person there has had some emotional issues. But we have the GPS system that we recommend with Alzheimer's patients. So, we have the LoJack system that we can activate. So if, you know, we have repeat patients who go missing, we encourage, obviously, their loved ones to apply for that program. So we can bring in the trackers, and we do for a lot of patients who go missing. And I can't tell you, at least once a night, it seems lately that we're searching the neighborhood for loved ones who walk away. But it's important that we document in that call that, there's someone there who is a, you know, frequent walker away or something like that. But we can make those notations, especially after the first
incident. That's good to know, and I'm just glad the public can be aware of that resource. And then just, just two quick questions around. So we've been talking a lot about people battling mental illness, but we know that EDP is, we're trying to get to sort of how do we quantify, because there's so many different characterizations. Is it possible to speak to what are your top two EDPs? Are they mental illness? Are they domestic violence? Are they drug related? Is it at all possible to sort of generally quantify sort of what you're seeing and what represents the lion's share?
You know, perhaps doing a review of the cases, we could try to narrow that down. Because when I give you the example, if it's alcohol that's got somebody upset or whatever, we could characterize that. And again, it's not to say that every single case is that dramatic, that this has to be a significant intervention or restraint or anything like that at the scene. That's more the exception, but obviously that's labor intensive and not, and can be difficult. Well, lots of times, some of the calls could be for somebody who's having a really bad grief reaction because of a death in the family and not handling too well, or a young person's been killed or whatever, and there might be just, so some of that is just come in, try and be supportive, getting there somewhere safe so they can get follow-up trauma services, because there's secondary.
I got it. There's a lot of gradations. You get all that. There. Okay.
So, but we could try to.
I was just curious because, again, to Counselor Wu's point on the prevention side, it just lets us know if you're seeing trends.
Where the best to direct.
You know,
efforts.
Where else do we need to be allocating resources before it gets to that critical place? So now my final question is, I believe you were saying that within the budget, two clinicians have been allocated. But are both those positions currently vacant? I just want to be clear about what your status is right now. Yeah.
So we currently have two full-time positions that are both currently in the process of being hired. Interviews, I believe, are going on currently. But yes, they are currently both vacant, one because the existing clinician went into the academy, the other because we lost a clinician when the previous grant expired, and now we have a new grant, which requires hiring a new person from the get-go. I also just want to add, just for anyone who is listening, that LoJack company? Is formally called Safety Net. For anyone who's looking into it, if they want to look into it, it's called Safety Net.
Great. Thank you so much. Yep. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman, and thank all of you.
Officer Sullivan, I know that you're here. I don't know what you'd like to add, and please do.
Well, thanks for having me. You know, I think that the folks up here have obviously shared quite a bit of experience. Sergeant Silton, in particular, with his 22 years, is quite a bit more than my four. I'd say just that my experience with the best team. Having gone through the academy recently, we were fortunate in that our curriculum there, part of it was taught by both the staff and a best team clinician. So prior to ever getting out into the field as recruits in the academy, we had a pretty good understanding of what resources were there. So we knew exactly how, you know, some of the preferred responses were from the police side, but also we knew about the resources that BEST had to offer. So I think that's something that these coming classes are obviously going to have a little more deeper understanding in terms of what that relationship is between BEST and the police. And I'd say that myself and my partner, Officer Driscoll, who's here with me, have been fortunate to work pretty extensively with the BEST team clinician, Ben, who's currently in the police academy, both on sort of the reactive side, so answering calls where there's a psychiatric component, but at the behest of Captain Hussein, who's here today, we were actually tasked with back last February putting together a little bit of a specialized approach for dealing with some of the EDPs in our district, which is District 3 Mattapan. So we have a couple locations on Blue Hill Ave that seem to really be sort of a hotbed for all sorts of quality of life issues. 911 calls for disturbances and fights and larcenies and drunk disturbances, but also tend to be a place where a lot of these folks that are high users of emergency services and deal with BEST, they tend to congregate there. So through that experience, I've really been able to see the value of the clinician. So if Jeff and I pull up and there's a known person to us who has, you know, a history of mental illness and some substance abuse issues, it's one thing for us to approach them and make an introduction and say hello. But obviously from there, it's really helpful having the clinician in the car that can really take that to sort of the next level. We're trying to get them, you know, in touch with services, whether it's more stable housing, whether it's substance abuse care, whether it's looping in with their existing team of doctors and making sure they're getting the kind of treatment that they need. So all in all, very, very positive experience. And I think that it's, you know, a relationship that for the line officers like myself is really valuable.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Welcome, Judge Coffey.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us today. And I'd love you to...
Thank you. Very much for the invitation. I'm honored. I'm delighted to be here. Just by way of background, my name is Kathleen Coffey. I'm a resident of the city of Boston. I took the orange line here today. I've been a judge in the West Roxbury Division of the Boston Municipal Court for 24 years. I'm feeling a bit old because both of my children went to Boston Latin School with Counselor O'Malley. I don't know about that. I do want to tell you that West Roxbury Court, it's a misnomer in many ways. That's what I tell my jurors each morning, because we actually represent 40% of the city of Boston. We represent the neighborhoods of Hyde Park, Rosendale, Jamaica Plain, West Roxbury, parts of Mattapan, and parts of Mission Hill. I am hopeful that my remarks today will shed some light on what we in the court system see and deal with every day in terms of mental illness. Mental illness is a challenge. It is something that judges see on a criminal basis as well as civil. Civil commitments, involuntary commitments, we hear those on a regular basis at the hospitals, Faulkner Hospital, Shattuck, as well as Arbor. And on the criminal side, we also address that quite frequently. Mental illness, alcoholism, and drug dependency are probably three of the largest challenges and the reasons why so many people enter the criminal justice system. I want to share with all of you a comment. I do run a mental health court in West Roxbury. I am the director of specialty courts for the Boston Municipal Court Department. I also run a homeless court at the Pine Street Inn. But I want to share with you a comment that a participant in our mental health session recently stated. He told me that having a mental illness is like being trapped on a runaway train going in the wrong direction. Hopelessness, a sense of despair, a sense of doom, a belief that life is not going to get better. That's the mindset, unfortunately, of many of the folks who the Boston Police and the BEST team and the courts work with on a regular basis. I think it's undisputed, and I think we all recognize, that mental illness rarely leads directly to criminal behaviors. But unfortunately, many of the mentally ill do end up in the court system due to bizarre behaviors or aggressive behaviors or acts that are perceived as being dangerous by the community. And consequently, a disproportionate number of the mentally ill are within the court system. When you compare the general population and you look at the vast number who are involved in the court system, it's grossly disproportionate. When you look at homelessness, Pine Street reports that 80% of the people who they shelter on a regular basis have co-occurring disorders, that being mental illness as well as addictions to drugs or alcohol. Sheriff Tompkins, in my conversations with him, he tells me that over 40% of those incarcerated suffer from a major mental illness. Experience also shows us that those who do suffer from a mental illness, even brief periods of detention, that only serves to exasperate their symptoms. So feelings of despair, paranoia, that's just going to be reinforced. And for many folks, once they do enter the criminal justice system, they do not fare well. Unfortunately, the characteristics of being disorganized or being fearful, distrustful, or anxious, the inability to appear on time to report to a probation officer, to report for a court case, often results in a whole cycle of defaults and rearrests, so that the mentally ill end up becoming part of this whole revolving door. So how do we break the cycle? And I think that's one of the biggest challenges that we as a community have. How do we break the cycle? Well, I would suggest to you that the legislation or the bill that's presently being considered by the City Council, it's an excellent way to break the cycle for three very important reasons. First of all, because it offers a diversion from the criminal justice system, from the courts into treatment. And the second, I think, important component of this bill is the fact that, and this hasn't been stated enough, and I think it's just because the police just accept, I think, on a certain level that their job is dangerous, but public, not only public safety, but police safety. And I can't emphasize that enough, that the officers who do, they put their lives and their safety on the line for every 911 call. And the presence of a clinician, the presence of a mental health professional at the scene is only going to de-escalate, defuse a potentially very dangerous situation. So I see this legislation not just a question of public health, public safety, but also officer safety. And I think that needs to be emphasize. The other piece to this is public trust and confidence. When the majority of people call 911, they're calling because they want the police to come and assist in a volatile situation. The vast majority of family members, guardians, spouses, they want the person removed. They do not want the person to end up in court. So what ends up typically happening is that once these cases do come to court, the family members, they don't want to go forward. They don't want to testify. So in terms of the court's ability to intervene and to provide treatment and access to justice, in many ways, it's challenged or handicapped. So this bill, in many ways, I see it as a public trust and confidence measure as well. Because if the perception, if the public perception is that when I call 911 to have my son removed because he hasn't been taking his medicines, because he is acting bizarre, and if the public perception is going to be that there is going to be, he's not going to necessarily be arrested, he's going to have access to treatment, then that increases the citizenry belief that the police are there to help them. And I think in this age, it needs to be stated that the courts, the police, our government, We need to continue to earn the respect of the public. And this, I think, is a very good measure to do that, so that the citizens of the city of Boston know that when they call 911, it is not inevitable that an arrest is going to take place, that there is going to be access to treatment and access to different venues. One of the speakers, I think it was Sergeant Silka, spoke about how, and this is a very important point, is that not every police action has to result in an arrest. There's another mechanism, and that is a summons. And an individual can come to court and have a clerk's hearing, and after that hearing, a complaint may or may not issue. So that's another tool that is available. And I think under this bill, that would be reinforced as well. So I do want to talk just briefly about what we in the courts are doing in terms of diverting people from the justice system into treatment, because there are several very important initiatives that are going on, and I'd like to take this opportunity to share that with you. Because I see the best team and I see the police as our justice partners for these three initiatives. First and foremost, we have mental health courts, specialty courts, and we also have drug courts. And I'm very proud to say that within the city of Boston, we actually have 9 specialty courts. We have 4 drug courts, 3 mental health courts. We have a homeless court. And I want to recognize Councillor Wu's sister, Sherelle, who was instrumental in helping us with the homeless court. And I also want to recognize one of my favorite police officers, Al Zalloway, who also has been instrumental and really a critical justice partner in helping us form the homeless court, which takes place on a monthly basis at the Pine Street Inn. But in terms of mental health courts, it's a specialty court, and Lauren Schneider is here from the BEST team and Boston Medical Center, and we work with BEST. We work with Boston Medical Center to assist people who are on probation to access treatment. There is increased supervision. And so consequently, the likelihood of their successfully completing probation is increased tenfold. And then the other initiative I wanted to speak about is our community justice project. And Jenna Savage has been working very closely with us on that project as well. And what that is, it's the courts have recognized that individuals suffering from mental illness and drug and alcohol issues, there needs to be a more active diversionary mindset. And so the community justice project that is ongoing involves community discussions with all the different players, and many of the officers who are here today have participated in that. And we look at our resources, our gaps, and the different intercepts in identifying ways in which individuals can be diverted. And this initiative that is before you today, this bill, I should say, that is part of, has been a very busy, major part of those discussions. So in conclusion, I just want to share with you a case, actually, that ended up in the mental health court. A case that I firmly believe would not have been in the court system if a clinician had responded to the scene. It happened about 2 years ago in Hyde Park. A mother called 911 because her son had not been taking his medicines, a DMH client. He was in a fetal position. He was in the bedroom. The lights were off, the shades were down, it was pitch black. The two officers who responded were new. They were young officers, and they were very patient with him, and they coaxed him out of the room, and they both testified. This matter went forward by way of a trial. And both the officers, young officers, they testified so earnestly that they pled with them, and they explained, and the mother testified too, that when she called 911, she just wanted her son out of the room because she was concerned, and he had been acting belligerently earlier. So the two officers that responded, they were patient, and they coaxed, and they promised, and they were there at the home, the testimony was, for close to 2 hours. And they were able to get that young man out of the room and onto the front porch. And they promised him that they would take him either to a shelter or they would take him to the hospital, whatever he wanted. Backup came, and the two officers who did come were not as patient as the first two officers. And so unfortunately, what happened was that this young man just lashed out at all four officers. And unfortunately, the officers were injured, and there were serious injuries. The individual had a long history of assaultive behavior. So after the jury trial occurred, both sides, both the Commonwealth and the defense attorney, recommended jail time because both sides, they figured that was it, that was the only option based on this young man's record. I suggested, why don't we try the mental health court? And I am so proud to say that young man received a substantial sentence. He had served time already awaiting trial, but he didn't serve additional time. He worked with Lauren Schneider with the BEST team. He came to court with increased supervision. He got a job. He started taking his medicines. He reunited with his therapist and his psychiatrist. And I'm so very proud to say that he completed those 3 years of probation without a new arrest. Without a new arrest. I'm not suggesting that or even predicting that the clinician there, who knows, the result may have been the same. But I do believe, I am confident, that the presence of a clinician, the presence of a trained mental health professional can only increase the administration of justice and make our communities a safer place to live and may also make it safe for the police. So I thank you for the opportunity, and if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you, Judge Coffey. Questions? Councilor Presley? You follow that.
I think you said it all, Judge. Thank you for what you do every day and for your testimony here. And I'd like to request a copy of it so that we can return to it. It will aid us well, not only in this specific endeavor, but in this work and how we approach it. I did have a question. The story you told, very compelling, very powerful story. I assume that story you shared is not an anomaly. So in the same ways that we're looking to reduce recidivism for those that are displaying criminal behavior that are not within these other subgroups, do you find that usually for those courts that is the only time you will see that person? Has it served well in terms of them not only not being incarcerated, but has that been the only time that they've come before you?
Yes, this is true. We actually have individuals who don't want to leave the mental health court because it provides them the support that they need, the structure that they need in order to be in compliance with their mental health treatment. And these individuals recognize that if they don't get that treatment, then their behaviors are at risk. Then they are at risk of being rearrested. So we actually have folks who don't want to leave us, believe it or not, which is, I think, a strong testament to the fine work that BEST does and that the probation department does and the efforts of the court system.
Absolutely.
We really are trying. The court system really is trying. And I think, especially under Chief Justice Paula Carey, there's a recognition that that so many people who are court involved should not be and need not be if the diversion occurs at the proper time. And this is one of the intercepts that has been recognized when it's that first 911 call.
And more clinicians at the scene.
Absolutely. Okay. To assist in not only informing the police and assisting them, but also the courts, because that information can be communicated to the judge in attempting to model a disposition that is fair and responsive to the needs of the individual. So the more information that is provided, not only to the police, but also to the courts, it's most helpful in ending this cycle, this revolving door.
And I very much appreciate your sort of larger three big bucket talking points around diversion, police safety, and public trust and confidence. So we will definitely remember that. I did want to get some clarity on, but again, we want to clarify the number of specialty courts we have, because I think you said nine, but
we do.
Okay, we were only able to count eight. Okay, so four drug courts, three mental health, and one homeless?
And one veterans treatment court.
Okay, very good. Okay. And then again, not only with the mental health specialty court, but with the drug, homeless, and veteran, that usually once someone has come before the court, they are put on a pathway to success and you don't see them again. That is by and large the case for all the courts, or is that
I could say that with complete certainty, but no, we do see some people.
Okay.
I mean, we do see some people. And recidivism is quite frankly only one measurement in terms of success. We also look at hospitalizations and employment.
Right.
And stability within their family. So, I mean, recidivism is just one measurement.
Thank you, Judge.
Thank you,
Madam Chairwoman.
Oh, thank you. And Judge Coffey, how does an individual access any of the specialty courts? How does that designation happen over general court?
They, they have to be court involved, obviously. Mm-hmm. And then the referral process is that attorney can refer an individual, a probation officer, if the individual, a lot of times, especially with mental illness, it doesn't surface immediately. So an individual will be on probation and then it will be noted by a probation officer. So the referral can be made then. The referral can be made by a judge or even a court officer. And the referral can be made at any time during the process. So at the arraignment or before disposition or post disposition.
Thank you very much. Anyone have more to add from this panel?
No, can I have Superintendent Holmes?
I think we'll switch over if folks want to.
Okay. No, I'm good.
If that's okay with you. Very good. All right, that's what we'll do. So
she can handle us all by herself.
I want you to hear her.
No. I think Superintendent Holmes is coming down. And
thank you all. Thank you so much.
Nancy's going to join you as well. Do you want to go? I don't know if you'll. It's up to you. If one of you or both of you want to stay, you might as well. But then.
We're still here. Good to see you. Thank you for being here. Happy Valentine's.
Thank you very much. And if, whichever order you'd like to, just introduce yourself for the record and.
Good afternoon. Superintendent Lisa Holmes, Chief of the Bureau of Professional Development, which encompasses the Police Academy and firearms training and cadet units.
Officer Nancy Salucci, also assigned to the Bureau of Professional Development.
Right. Will you talk to us a little bit, either one, about what happens up at the Academy? Give us a little bit of a picture of the training.
Okay, well, the training for the recruits is roughly 6.5 months. It's over 1,100 actual educational hours that they receive. And although we have courses that are specifically dedicated to law enforcement response, to EDPs and de-escalation. So let me back up. There's a specific course on law enforcement response to EDPs, which Officer Salucci is the lead instructor. Although that's a state-mandated 16 hours worth of recruit training, every course that the officers take in the academy is cross-referenced. So de-escalation and response to the citizens suffering from mental illness is cross-trained throughout the entire 1,100 hours. because there really isn't one specific situation that an officer responds to where we may not encounter someone suffering from mental illness. So as they learn their patrol procedures, they learn how to respond in case the person may be suffering from mental illness. As they learn how to respond to DV, domestic violence calls, that's also trained. So it's not just specific hours that they get. They get it through their entire training. And as far as the content, Officer Salucci would be better suited because she actually teaches it.
Right. Officer Salucci?
So clearly there's some distinctions between an emotionally disturbed person by virtue of the situation that may be going on versus someone that's clinically diagnosed as having a mental illness. So we do, again, like the superintendent said, we do have cross-references to kind of gauge people and encounter them, diffuse them, de-escalate them, and then get them to a calmer state of mind in an effort to figure out what's going on. Is it what has occurred that's caused that emotional breakdown, or is there a clinical mental illness going on? So we have to kind of differentiate between the two and then make our best decisions on what we have at the surface. And sometimes that is, it's by virtue of what's going on, we still can't get them calmed down and it may become an EMS problem. Other times it's a clinically diagnosed mental illness, and maybe we need some help with psychological support, whether it's a clinician or coming from the best team to help de-escalate that situation.
And as Officer Sullivan said, we are fortunate the last 4 or 5 years, the training for officers has really strongly focused on dealing with people suffering from mental illness. I believe the e-learning was in, 2011?
Yeah.
2000, prior to my taking over command of the academy. But that has been very instrumental in our officers learning how to utilize the best team. And just our last in-service cycle for the police academy for our veteran officers, which ran September of 16 through December, all our veteran officers had a 3-hour course on police response to mental illness. So you don't only get this training when you're in the academy. We strongly believe that it's something that has to be trained constantly. And new procedures come out and new information. And so we have to keep our officers updated as to what are the best practices in responding to these incidents. And I agree with Judge Coffey, and I was so very happy to hear her say that although we do a great job with training our officers and giving them the tools that they need to respond to these calls, we are not clinicians, and we strongly, strongly need the help of them to assist us in these calls because we can't determine really what's going on. We, as Officer Salucci said, we can take an overall look at a situation and give it what our judgment or our best guess could be, but we strongly need the help of a licensed clinician with us.
And the training, the professional development of your officers on an ongoing basis, how often will that occur? You just mentioned the 3 hours that the veteran officers received this past fall. Will that continue? Is there a yearly commitment?
It's a cycle. So we lessons will come up or different tactics will come up through the year. And we will put together in service what best would suit the community and the officer's needs. So this year, we knew that we needed to update them on some new laws about mental illness, so we brought them in. If we can't get them in physically, we will create e-learnings that everybody has to take. So although our in-service and e-learnings are on a yearly cycle, the topic will change depending on the needs of the officers of the community. Or the city, I should say.
And that's 100% of the officers, or is it uniform?
We have 100% compliance with e-learning. Every sworn member of the police department must take their e-learnings. We just expanded them from we just expanded them from 4 to 8. So we're going to split it up. Instead of 4 on a yearly basis, they will now have to take 6 a yearly. So 3 in the first quarter, 3 in the first half, and 3 in the second half. So we'll be employing a little bit more because it's actually it's more cost effective, and it's easier to get officers to learn through the e-learning because we don't have to pull them off the street. And they do it in their station. They have a few hours every day where they sit down and they can do it. And it gets the message out to more people in a faster method than bringing them into the academy.
Thank you. So what does that e-learning consist of? Is it sort of a survey?
No.
You go to a scene and you see this, check this, check
no,
this?
No, we develop, they're like mini movies. We develop okay. training, we do scenarios.
Okay, that was my question.
Yeah,
okay.
And then after each scenario, depending on the subject, they have to take a test.
Okay.
After each scenario. So we develop them. They take about 4 to 6 months to develop. So we're on my staff. I have an e-learning staff, which is 3 people, really. And they develop them based on the topic. We have a cinematographer that comes in, and they do it, and it's on a server.
Oh, so these are our own. We're not even subscribing to...
No. We develop them. So my staff develops them and makes, produces
yes,
them.
Yes, so I was... Actually, that was my next question, because you were saying that... and I'm, you know, pleased to hear that the education is ongoing, that it's not a one-off. And you were saying that you'll sort of get lessons, you know, from the field, if you will, and kind of bring that back. So how was that reported back? Are, you know, folks, you know, out there and saying, we're seeing a lot of this, or I didn't feel that the
yeah,
curriculum
we do. That's how we usually prepared. Get it. Officers will come to somebody in the staff and they say, look, we're running into this situation
okay.
in the field. Is there anything you can, you know, do to get us some more information or get us some more tools? And staff will sit down and we talk about and we'll see what we can develop and put together for them. But a lot of our information, if it doesn't come from the state as to updates that we need to provide the officers with, a lot of it does come from requests from officers looking for additional tools to help them do their job.
And so what informs those tools? Real life experience and knowledge, or are there specific sort of standard resource books or guides? I guess I'm wondering, is there a model that we refer to? Is there a city, another city model that we replicate that...
For our e-learning?
Yes.
I think we...
Or this training?
It started before I took over.
I see,
so,
okay.
But I believe we were the ones that came up with and developed it. We have actually had inquiries from other police departments across the country.
I see.
On how to institute e-learning themselves.
All right, thank you very much. Oh, you know, I did just want to just add that, again, to your point about why this resource works in a much more effective sort of tandem in the interest of the public safety and health, it's no different than our advocacy for more social workers and school nurses within Boston Public Schools. You know, many of our teachers by default assume those roles. And so you could do the cross-training so that they have those indicators of when a child is experiencing trauma and what are those barriers to learning, but there's nothing like the investment of a dedicated social worker. It frees up that educator to focus on what they need to do,
exactly.
which is educating that child. And so to me, it's just the same.
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry about that. Thank you all. Do you have anything else to add, anyone, before we get to public testimony?
No, ma'am.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank
you
very much.
Okay. I've been holding for 40 minutes.
I do want to just thank all that presented today and were able to share their experiences and their knowledge. It certainly gave me a much deeper understanding of this, really of the need for this work and for us to be committed to it fully as a city. And when I say fully, I mean funded. I do have one person who signed up for public testimony, Hope Half. Would you like to come up and share your testimony, please?
Oh, no, it's okay. Oh, yeah, no, I wouldn't want to be offended. I've literally been holding my breath for 45 minutes. Oh. Number one.
Where would you like me?
Wherever you're most comfortable. And Hope, if you would, for the record, just introduce yourself and any affiliation or particular interest or license.
My name is Hope Half. I'm a resident of Boston, and I want to thank the city councilors, Ayanna Presley particularly, and others that have worked on it, also the police and the judge. I think if it had gotten out that this was under discussion, you would have many, many mental health clinicians here. I am one of those. I'm a LICSW. Actually, I'm a retired LICSW. And I worked with many poor clients who did end up involved with the courts. And I was paid by the health system, which does not pay for interaction with courts and police. That is, they will pay for 10 minutes of it, but not more. And I often, or not often, but several times I had the experience of a young person with mental illness. The mother, pretty overwhelmed, called for reinforcement from the police. And it ended up in a court appearance. It was immensely stressful for the family and for the mentally ill child, and quite expensive for the public. And I think it's wonderful that I retired 8 years ago. It sounds like there's a lot more diversion available, although maybe not as much as we need. Maybe 25% of what we need. So I want to thank everybody for the efforts they have made. I also, a group of social workers formed the Massachusetts Bail Fund in order to bail people out before they go to court when they have not yet been convicted, because we found that it's extremely hard on families and the patients to be in jail up until their trial. And I can only say this informally because we don't officially diagnose these customers of ours. We bailed, I think, for $16,000 this month. We are all volunteers. The money is not a grant, but is given by people who are concerned. So that was probably at least 32 people. And I would say, just as a guess, as a mental health person, a third to a half had a mental health or substance abuse problem, which brought them into the criminal justice system. An enormous loss of public funds to have them in jail and actually not helping, unless they were with Judge Coffey, their mental health. So anything you can do in this direction, I think that the measure which is now before you, if it can be funded any more than it possibly is, it will be a great saving for the public, for the taxpayer. It will make it safer for police and definitely better for the mental health of the community. So I did want to say one other thing, and that is there have been violence prevention programs where clinicians were called after a murder. And I think that that, I hope that that's still being funded. I retired 8 years ago. I saw how valuable it was. Cambridge Health Alliance was manning that at the time. But I think that prevents further murders because friends and siblings of the murdered one will tend to go and look for revenge. If there are counselors present reaching out to the family, that is much less likely to happen.
Absolutely. And there was just a rollout of a more updated neighborhood response team, specifically focused on trauma response and recovery. So we are getting closer to establishing that citywide protocol to support those families in the wake of violence, because you're right, it does break cycles of violence.
Absolutely.
Especially retaliatory.
Right. I don't think I mentioned that I'm a member of the Criminal Justice, did I mention this? Criminal Justice Committee of the National Association of Social Workers, Massachusetts.
No.
As well as the Mass Bail Fund. So,
thank you very much. Good to see you representing FWP very well. Good to see you.
Councilor Presley, do you have closing comments?
Great hearing, Madam Chairwoman. Quite the education and We tested a lot of assumptions here today that I think were proven, and it's encouraging to see that we're all in agreement of the need to make a more formidable financial investment in the BEST program for all the reasons previously stated. So I look forward to your continued partnership and more to come.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And thank you again to our guests today and to our public comment and certainly to our colleagues for their thoughtful questions. I'm proud to co-sponsor this with you and look forward to really finding a real and sustainable funding source for the BEST program, not just to support the current work, but to really expand upon that work for the city of Boston. This meeting's adjourned.